righteous, that you are everlasting. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, that you are all powerful, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. We will rejoice and be glad in it because we serve a holy God. We serve a righteous God, an all-powerful God. And we thank you, Lord God, for this day, Lord God. We magnify your name, oh God. We thank you, Holy Spirit. We yield to you today, Lord God, to have your way, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for you have done all things, oh God, great, that you are our God, that you are our Father, and we honor your name today, God, giving you all the praise, the glory, and the honor, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for your son Jesus, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that he done all things well, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, and we lift you up, Father God, and we speak, Lord God, to the north, the south, the east, and the west, Father God, that you know those that don't have a God, that don't know you as God. Father God, send them, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, Father God. We thank you, Lord God. We magnify your name, oh God. Be glorified in this house, oh God. You said, whom the Son set free is free indeed. So be free in God today. It's a choice to be free in God because God has done all things well, Father God. We thank you, Lord God, for your word, oh God, for there is life in the word of God. We thank you, Lord God. The word of God said that he would do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask, think, or imagine, but it's according to the power that worketh in us, oh God. So, Father God, we thank you for the power, Lord God, that we will stir ourselves up, oh God. We thank you, Lord God, that we will not look to the left or to the right. We will not look to who is here and who is not here, but we will look to you, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, oh God. We thank you, Lord God, for your word. Have your way in your house today. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah.
Living Word. God, it's all about you today, Lord. Our worship and our praise and our adoration, it all goes to you. It all belongs to you anyway. So God, we take our minds off the things of the earth below and we set our affections on you today. We cause our hearts and our spirits and our eyes to draw nearer to heaven, to your throne room. And God, we're asking in this place today that you will fill us with your Holy Ghost. Fill us with your love and your peace. Fill us with your power and fill us with your presence. For God, we've come to realize and recognize that you are everything that we need. There is nothing that we can't find in you. There's nothing that you can't do for us. There's not enough love to go around. Yes, there is, because God, you can love each and every one of us differently in the way that we need, but there's still more than enough of you. And God, we know that with you and in your presence, there is always satisfaction guaranteed, because you already know our end. You already knew our beginning. You know where we were going to be right here, right now, at this moment and at this day and time. For God, you change not, your ways change not. We don't understand them, but your ways change not. You are God always. And we love on you in your very presence this morning. I don't know about you, but I know I need a filling of the Holy Ghost. I know I need a filling of the presence of God. I know I need a filling of his joy and of his peace. I don't know what it is that you're coming searching of this morning, but I want you to ask God to fill you up with that very thing today. The fire is already made. The sacrifice he needs is your worship and your praise. And it's something you don't even really have to go and search for. And if you're not sure what that means, or how to do it, let me just show you. It's simply easy as saying, I love you, Lord. Or saying, Father, I need you. Just telling God, thank you. Or as easy as calling on the name of Jesus. And God, I thank you, Lord God, that the enemy is bound in this place, because you said whatever we bind on earth, you will bind in heaven. So I thank you, Lord God, that he is bound here, as you bind them in heaven. And I thank you that adoration and worship is loosed here as it is loosed in heaven, so that we may find freedom and liberty wherewith you have made us free, God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I thank you for the fire. I thank you that you've allowed me to have a praise to be a sacrifice unto you. Saturate us with your spirit in this place, so that we can open up to you like never before, honoring your very presence. You provide the fire, and now provide the sacrifice. You provide the spirit. I will open up inside. Fill me of God. Fill me of God. Fill me of God. Fill me of. Fill me of God. Fill me of God. Fill me of. If you provide the fire, then I'll provide the sacrifice. If you provide the spirit, oh yes, then I will open up inside. Fill me of God. Fill me of God. Fill me of God, fill me of God. From your mouth this morning, set them in the atmosphere.
Thank you, Lord God.
To change your situation, to move the atmosphere. Hallelujah. Oh yes, Lord. We know that it's cloudy on the outside. But I love when I see those clouds, because there's a sign that there's rain coming. And with rain, it washes away those things that shouldn't be and allows those things that should live to grow up and stay alive. So God, I thank you for your shower of blessings that you're scattering full and free, showering our thirsty souls and refreshing us. God, I ask you this morning to let some drops now fall on us here in this place. Even me in the state that I'm in. Even my brother and sister in the state that they are in. God, we ask you to let it rain in our life. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Do you want God to reign in your life? Open the floodgates of heaven. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open
the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain.
Oh, Let the rain of your presence come and wash away some things in my life today. Flood our lives with your presence this morning, Lord. I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my pain. Joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord. Can you say that with me this morning? Let's worship him this way. I'm trading
my sorrow.
I'm trading my
shame.
I'm laying them down
for the joy of the Lord.
I'm trading my
pain.
voice so I can say yes, Lord, yes. Whatever you will be done in our lives, Lord.
Yeah. that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call. And is it true that you are thinking of me? Oh, how you love me is amazing, so amazing.
You love him this morning? Come on, don't you love him this morning? He's worthy of our praise. Glory to God. Susan, come right now, sweetheart. Remain standing. Let's just take a brief moment. Susan came to me and said, Pastor, we've had a miracle. Had a miracle this week in our lives. Listen to this incredible testimony.
Good morning. Wednesday morning, my husband fell off the back of a semi-truck. When he landed, he crushed every bone in his wrist. They said he had no wrist. When they took pictures, it said it looked like somebody had taken an egg, dropped the egg, and then took a hammer and smashed the egg. It was all just bone, just fragments. They were talking 3 hours surgery. They were talking rods, pins. They were talking about having to put something on the outside of his arm once they stitched him back up. They were talking about 3 or 4 different surgeries. The surgery he originally went in for, they said the best they could do is hope to keep his arm stable, because literally his palm of his hand was literally touching his wrist down here. He had nothing. So I said, okay, I'm not accepting this, because he doesn't come to church. He's working on, you know, on Lord. He doesn't really know if he believes or not. Well, he does now. So I just said, we're not accepting this, and I prayed over his wrist. The surgeon came in. And he told us even more detail how much worse it really was. And he starts passing. I said, look, don't worry. God's got this. I'm telling you. Amen. So he tells me, I'll see you in 3 hours. Go do what you got to do. So I went for about an hour, came back. The doctor came in. I forgot about that. So that's the most poor part. Then when the doctor came in and I told him I don't accept this, I said, I already prayed about it. The doctor goes, well, good. He goes, I'm a Christian. He goes, it's all in God's hands anyway. He goes, God just works through my hands. It's all up to God. Woo, hallelujah. So an hour goes by, I come back in, I'm against something to eat because I was feeling fine. I knew I was all right. So we go back in there and the surgeon was sitting there and I said, is he all right? Because I was expecting 3 hour surgery. He goes, ma'am, he goes, I don't even know what to tell you. He goes, when I cut open his wrist, he goes, the fragments were almost like they were just there. There was nothing to his wrist. One surgeon started pulling on one side, the other started pulling on the other. He goes, all of a sudden, the bones just all came together. He goes, we just put a pin in, put one plate, hallelujah. One surgery, 23 minutes was all it took, 23 minutes. So now he has this, and the idiot, went back to work that night after the surgery. Of course, he had to come back home. He's out of work now for a little while, but praise God, he's got his wrist back, and he's going to be fine. He's in pain, but hallelujah. I mean, woo. He said that thing just came up and healed like he couldn't believe it. He couldn't believe it. So praise God. Thank you, Lord. All I was thinking about was, where's our money going to come from? No, that's terrible, but.
I like that too. Come on, give God praise. Come on, you can do better than that. We got another miracle.
My mom, about a month ago, she was diagnosed. They said there was a lump, a mass in her left breast. She was having shortness of breath. I talk loud. she had to go and get, I don't know, the scope down her throat. So before the surgery, I had prayer. We had prayer with her for God to dissolve that mass. That day, he went in and he didn't see anything through the throat. He didn't see anything. But that following week, that's when she had to go and do the mass, what do you call it, MRI. So she went in, they said that she was going to be there for 3 hours. So I told her that, so my sister took her. So I was prepared to pick her up. So like an hour later, the nurse called me. Oh, let me go back. They had already given her the medicine for the, so she can have the MRI because she had to be drug, because they had to do a biopsy. They had given her the medicine to sedate her. But then they did a scan. So when they went and did the scan, they found nothing. They found nothing. The doctor said to her that you must have prayed. It was not there. So we give all the glory to God. So I just thank God, because we as the children of God, we have to exercise our faith. Everything that we need, it's already been done through the finished work of Christ. It's already been done. But we gotta know his word. We gotta know it. If we don't know his word, we're blind to the things of God. He said everything that pertains to life and godliness, he's already given it to us. But until we exercise our faith, and he also said, cast not away our confidence. Don't cast away your confidence when things look like it ain't going your way. But we got to remember that it's already done through Christ Jesus. Amen. Giving hallelujah. All the glory. Amen, amen. Hallelujah.
Good preaching, girl. Come on, Gateway. Let's praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, can you stand one more?
Yeah.
This one's mine. You know, in the past, I've had those kidney stones flare up. Now, you just had one, what, about a month ago, a couple weeks ago, and you know how bad the pain is, right? I mean, it's incredible. How many know kidney stone pain? They call it the male childbirth. Because that's what they call it, because the pain is so. How many men have had it? You know what I'm talking about. It's like you hit your face on the ground and you scream, and where's my mama? Because it hurts so bad. And you never know when it might flare up and this thing starts moving. And I've battled these over the years. On Tuesday, I could not move. Shortly after Kay left the house to come to the church, I literally almost was paralyzed because of the pain, the kidney stone pain. I could not make it Wednesday night. I told Craig, I said, have the church pray. Because I'm in so much pain, I cannot even get to church on Wednesday night. So for 2 solid days, I had that kidney stone pain, and I told you all to pray. How many of you were here Wednesday night praying for me? Somebody touched God for me. I'm not exaggerating for 1 minute. All of a sudden, I had to check my watch. The pain totally left, and it was about 7:30. Every inch of pain left my body and has not come back yet. Come on, you can do better than that. I'm going to praise the Lord whether you do or not. 2 solid days, and you all prayed for me on Wednesday night, sometime in that service, and somebody touched heaven for me, and 7:30 it left and hadn't come back. Amen. Glory be to God. Come on, how many know Jesus is still a healer? Hallelujah. Lift your hands toward heaven one more time. Maybe you're here this morning, and you might be battling something in your body, something physical. In the name of Jesus, just receive. Arnett said it all. It's already been done. The price has already been paid. By his stripes, we were healed. We're healed. Past tense. All we have to do is release our faith and accept it and receive it as done, because it's already been done for us at the cross. Do you believe that this morning? Whatever it is, you just claim it right now. Lord, touch bodies in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we love you. Lord, we thank you for your awesome power. Lord, we trust you. Even when it doesn't look like anything's happening, doesn't feel like anything's happening, the devil's lying to us. Lord, we stand on your word. Your word is true. Hallelujah. 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 Now let's thank him and let's praise him. Hallelujah. Oh, I exalt thee. Yes, I exalt. Church this morning. Somebody say it with me, say, I'm in the right place at the right time for the right reason. If you believe that, turn, find somebody you didn't come with this morning, give them a big hug and a handshake and tell them that right now. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. It's a good day. The day that the Lord has made. We rejoice, glad in it. Amen, amen, amen. We welcome you. If this is your very first time at Gateway, you are our special guest. We have a little something we want to just put in your hand and not embarrass you, but recognize you. Who's here for the very first time? Anyone here for the very first time? Even one first-time guest? No? Not even one. Well, then it's family. Amen. If you'll pull out your bulletin real quick, I'm not going to tarry long on this, but I am excited because today we are announcing that we have an adult school of the Bible.
Hallelujah.
Now, if you're over a certain age like I am, you went to Sunday school. Yeah, who went to Sunday school? Okay. Yeah. But that was for like little kids, you know what I mean? But this is Sunday school for adults. And we have a teacher, not just a teacher or any teacher, but we have a special teacher, a very, very capable teacher. And if you don't know her, I want Paula, just if you could come just real quick. Come on, sweetheart. I want to introduce our teacher. Amen. Amen. And we've prayed about this, haven't we? We prayed about it. And I'm so comfortable with, I'm just so excited. This is a leader and a woman of God in our church, her and her husband, amen. And, you know, we thought we had a class in place and things just didn't work and some wrenches got thrown in there and that's no problem, but it kind of delayed us for a little while. But I know this is the Lord and she's excited about it. I want her just to take a moment and just share what we're going to do. We're going to teach the book of James. Yes, tell them about it.
Before I say that, I say many are the plans in the heart of a man, but it's the purposes of the Lord that prevails. So his purpose will always prevail. In studying the book of James, we are going to do this together. We are going to do the backstory because remember, all these books, none of these books, not one of them was written to you or I. So we first have to look at who the audience was and what was the audience's understanding of what was written. And then we look at what it means to you and I. Because remember, the Word of God is God-breathed.
Yes.
So
right.
We have to establish that the Word of God is true.
Right.
So whether it was written 400 years ago to whoever, it has an application for us today.
Yes.
And that is what we are going to study, what the application for us today is. But we first have to go back, look at what the situation was. So every book we study, anytime we come to the Word of God, we must be detectives. What was happening?
Right.
Why was it happening?
Yes.
Where was it happening?
Good.
To whom was it happening?
Yes.
So that we can get the right context,
right,
because we must rightly divide the Word of God.
Yeah.
We can't just have any notion in our heads.
Right.
We must rightly divide it.
Right.
And I told Pastor Joe that whatever we can't figure out, he'll figure out. So if we come to an impasse, don't worry. I will tell you, I'm honest, I'll tell you, I don't have the answer on this one. Ask the Holy Spirit. We ask the Holy Spirit, and then we ask Pastor Joe and the Holy Spirit, because the Lord has put him as the angel of this house. So I know he has invested in him. So what we don't know there, he'll know. And what he doesn't know, the Holy Spirit will know. So I welcome you to the book of James.
Yes.
And I hope to see you all come Sunday, March 6th. Thank you.
Fifth. Oh, amen. It's the fifth. Praise the Lord. All they need to do is just bring their Bible, bring something to write in notes, right? And we're going to go verse by verse after they get the backdrop, the context of the book, and they're going to take notes for that, and then verse by verse through the entire book.
Remember, I am going to bring I'm going to bring some books that I use, and I'll also ask Pastor Joe for some of his books, so that while we are discussing in class, if there's something we need to look up, we can. But the first thing we do is interpret Scripture with Scripture. We always look for precedent in God's Word before. I hate going to concordances and men's thinking on the matter before I hear what God's Word says. I only go there when I want a little more enlightenment. This thing isn't making sense. Then I listen to somebody's thoughts.
Uh-huh.
And then we can put together. And I know that each and every one of us will be blessed. Because this is God's word and it never returns void.
Hallelujah.
That's what the word of God says.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Let's just pray right now. Stand and pray. Hallelujah. Father, Lord, we've tarried months and we've waited, and Lord, we believe the time is right now. And Lord, I just thank you for the heart of Paula to do this and to teach this and to take this on. And Lord, I just ask for a special touch of the Holy Spirit, Lord, as she opens her heart and her mouth
to share with the people in this congregation. Lord, you are going to use her. You're going to speak through her. Lord, we receive her as a gift from heaven for this class. Lord, let the same unction and anointing that's on me, Lord, come on her to teach. And Lord, let us receive great things from your word as a result of this class. And we just commit it to you, and we just expect it to start strong and grow and be fruitful in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. It's going to be, I was going to get there. We're going to do it in the fellowship hall. We have classes, you know, classrooms, but all of them are upstairs, up through those treacherous steps. And we just talked about that and felt like there would be a few people that are incapable of getting up those steps, you know, that will want to come. So we're going to make, as you know, we've got a lot of stuff still in the fellowship hall because of the sale. And there's another sale to come, as you know, down the road. So we can't just take all of that out of there. But I've talked to Craig, and the guys have an understanding. We're going to make a section there, put up about 20, 25 chairs, something like that, whatever we need, and just turn Paula loose and let you come. Amen. 9 o'clock, so that's a full hour early. You have to get up early and come, obviously. And maybe we can have somebody, you know, bring some, you know, turn the coffee on, come early and turn the coffee on or something. Maybe if some people need a coffee, you know, in the morning or something, and maybe, I don't know, nothing real unhealthy, but, you know, something, cinnamon cake or something, I don't know, whatever. You got, you girls can figure that out and be creative with that. But we're excited about it. We can just encourage you to come, all right? And also in your bulletin there, you'll see, by the way, I haven't had this on in a long, long time. I just figured, hey, I know I'll be a little warm, but if I can wear it, I'm putting it on and going to wear it to church. They came in the office and they about fell out. They said, who's in pastor's office? He's got some vest on. We don't know who that is in there. So you keep praying. It's coming off. Hallelujah. And I'm feeling great. Praise God. Amen. Stay in the course. You know, they say if you do anything for 21 days, it's a habit, you know. And we figured out last night or yesterday, right, that I fasted for 42 days. So that's twice of 21. So those old bad eating habits are broken. And new eating habits are now instilled in my life. So we're just going to stay the course. I was a little discouraged. I wanted it to come off, you know, immediately. And that's not going to happen. That was foolish for me to think. But all the old eating habits are gone. New eating habits. Getting healthy. And the weight will just take care of itself. Amen. You keep praying for me, but I'm on course, and we're doing well. We're excited about it. Hallelujah. Now, where was I? Oh, yeah, celebrate recovery. Amen. And as you can see, even pastor might need celebrate recovery, because you don't have to be addicted to drugs or alcohol or sex or, you know, have some kind of demon in you or something to think that, you know, you need the plan of celebrate recovery. All of us. Amen. Even me, so I've been reprogramming my thinking concerning, you know, things that I've talked about, bad eating habits. I just saw that it was like I was medicating my pain with food. And as if a pastor can do that, then anybody can do that. And at least it wasn't women or drugs that I was doing, but, you know, fried chicken, you know, and double stuffed crust, cheese crust, double meat pepperoni pizzas, and, you know, junk like that. So I was medicating with the wrong thing. And so all of us probably has an area in our life where there's still an infirmity there. There's still a weakness there. Come on, somebody. There's still an area there that we need to reprogram our thinking and be more Christ-like, be a greater example for Christ. And, you know, mine was my food. So everybody, you know, may not relate to that, but I trust me, there's some area. all the studies show that the number, the percentages of abuse are staggering. They say that one in every four males were somehow sexually abused when they were young. One in three women were somehow sexually violated or abused when they were young. So, I mean, if those numbers are true and those are the numbers that they say, you know, if you look around, you know, if you have enough people, you just know certainly by just percentages that there's a number of people that may have things that have happened in the past. Now, maybe God has healed you and you've released that and you've dealt with that. But how many know sometimes we just stuff things? Come on, that was what I was. I was just stuffing, and then the bag got full, and then guess what? It exploded. It blew up. And so we've got people that are emotionally damaged, emotionally wounded. And that's what Celebrate Recovery is all about. Don't think it's just for the drunkard or something, you know, or the glutton. It's for all of us. So Celebrate Recovery is coming. You need to know it's coming. Probably, maybe as early as next Sunday, I'm going to minister on this myself and teach for a couple of weeks. But we are pointed to Wednesday, March, what is it? March 8th, thank you, to launch this. And some of you have thankfully already stepped forward to be leaders. And you know who you are. And Craig wanted me to remind all of the leaders. The meeting is what, Craig? Tomorrow night at 7 p.m., right? 7 o'clock right here for upstairs in the classroom, about an hour and a half. You leaders know who you are, and we're preparing those leaders for the target date to launch on that Wednesday the 8th. And it's for everybody. Amen. So if somebody asks, well, we just going to do this forever? No, we're not going to do it. On Wednesdays forever, but we are going to launch it and do it for some season. I don't know how long, weeks, months, whatever, for some season on Wednesdays, simply because we want to get as many people accessible to it. Does that make sense? Amen. And get into it. And then once you get in it, once you come one time, that's it, man. You got to come. You get so ministered to, you're going to come back. Amen. Just like Sunday morning. You know, if we didn't have anything to offer you, you wouldn't come back. But we do, so you come back. Amen. So the same thing with Celebrate Recovery. So for some season, probably a couple of months, we're going to just do that on Wednesdays, and that will be our Wednesday night service. And you're going to, mark my words, you're going to see that this program touches so many people, even outside this church. There's going to be people coming here on Wednesdays that are not even members of this church that are coming to this program on Wednesday nights. You watch. We'll have a number. I don't know how many. That's up to the Lord. But you watch. There'll be people that come that are a part of another church, but they're coming here on Wednesday nights to be a part of this ministry program. Last time we did this a number of years ago, it was just amazingly successful. And maybe we ought to have a couple of testimonies or something ready, Craig. Maybe I'm just thinking on that night. Because the first Wednesday, we're going to do family night, right? Isn't that right? What is that, the first or something? I don't have a calendar in front of me. First or second or something? Maybe we could have some testimonies. This is just coming to me right now under the anointing, Craig. Let's do that. Let's have some people set up to give kind of brief testimonies about the Celebrate Recovery from the last time when we did it. And if we don't have the actual people, Carol can share some testimonies, because I know that, you know, little Catherine. How many know little Catherine? She's going to be 101, right? And when we did the program, she was like 90-some years old, right? Served God her whole life. She's going to be 102. Oh, she's amazing. She was in the Celebrate Recovery program, 90-some years old. And God delivered her of some stuff that she had asked God for to heal her of for years and years and years. Now, if that's for godly little Catherine in her 90s, none of us think, I'm good, I'll just stay home. Are you kidding me? How many here in my heart on this? Amen. So anyway, I've said enough about that. The leaders meeting is Monday. We're fully behind this. We're fully supportive of this. We're going to promote it, and there's ways that we're going to advertise it, not advertise it, but promote it that it's here, and there'll be people coming from across the area. Hallelujah. I feel so strong. Glory to God. I feel so strong. Hallelujah. When the hand of the Lord is on you, you can do no harm. You can do no wrong. Man, it's great. Praise the Lord. I want the ushers to come. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. If you can put that verse up, Deuteronomy 26:10, please. Deuteronomy 26:10. And now behold, I have brought the first fruits. Say first fruits. I have brought the first fruits of the land which thou, O Lord, has given me. And thou shalt set it before the Lord thy God and worship before the Lord thy God. The first fruits is another word for tithe, and tithe is another word for tenth. And the first fruits, how many know the Bible says, are holy unto the Lord. And when we bring it, we don't just, you know, reluctantly write that check or, you know, count out our cash and stick it in there and bring it down and plunk it in a plate, you know, kind of with an bad attitude. You know, I saw a man of God, I won't name who it was, but trust me, it was a true servant of God. And he was telling how, let me make sure I get the story right, a great former, is now with the Lord, but a great patriarch of the faith in a previous generation was taken into the unseen realm of heaven. Now, some of these things that you hear about, you just, I ain't got time to listen to somebody's imagination, you know. But how many know you, when you hear something, your spirit tells you a ring, that ring is true. You ever had that? And where they're telling their experience, they were caught up in heaven or whatever, and your spirit just bears witness. You know what? That's not just out of a pizza dream or something. You know what I mean? That's, you bear witness. How many of you ever had that happen? You bear witness, that's true. Well, this was a mighty, mighty patriarch. And anyway, one of the things that they saw in heaven was when the offering was taken, there was an angel. And an angel wrote down the attitude of the heart of the people when they gave in the offering. I don't have a verse for it, but you know what? I can see that. And it wasn't so much the measure of the amount. It was, they were looking at their willingness, their joyfulness. How many know the Bible says he loves a cheerful giver? God looks at our heart, amen, when we put our offering in the plate. Come on, somebody. That's biblical. And this person, who I won't name, but trust me, it wasn't some flaky person. They were telling this and retelling what this person had seen. And the angel, and up in heaven, they've documented in the books of heaven, every time we would give a gift to the Lord, what was our heart? Where was our heart at? Was there joy in our heart? Was there, you ready? Worship. Amen. How many know when we're worshiping, we can be running, dancing, jumping, hands up, singing loud, but God sees what's in our heart. How many know God can tell whether it's true worship or not? I'm trying to help you this morning. If you'll hear me out, I'm not just taking up an offering. I'm trying to help you here. Because this says that when we bring that first fruit, we what? We worship the Lord with it. It's not just our singing that is worship. It's not just our clapping that is worship. It's not just our bowing that is worship. It's not just our uplifted hands that is worship. When we give and we bring that first fruit, it's an act of worship. So stand with me, because this is our prayer this morning. As I give in today's offering, I rejoice as I bring to the Lord the first fruits of my income and my increase. Look at this. I worship the Lord with a grateful heart, for he has provided faithfully for me. How many know God's been good to all of us? You may not drive a Hummer and live in a mansion, but God's been good to you. Come on, somebody. Amen. You know he's been good to you. Think of where you were without him. So we have a lot to be thankful for. We have a lot to be grateful for. So I worship the Lord with a grateful heart, for he has provided faithfully for me and my house. I give willingly and cheerfully. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. That's our prayer this morning. From the back to the front, as we sing and lead, come and let's worship the Lord with our giving this morning.
Trials come going. He can give you peace down in your soul. He is always true. He will be there for you. Will you believe him? Will you receive him? God is able. God is able. God is able to do what he said he would do.
Ron Canoli.
There, it's on. Flip the switch, Joe. All right, stretch your hands out toward this, and let's pray this and declare this. Hallelujah. As I give in today's offering, I rejoice as I bring to the Lord the first fruits of my income and my increase. I worship the Lord with a grateful heart, for he has provided faithfully for me and my house. I give willingly and cheerfully. Hallelujah. Lord, document. Let the angels document, Lord, the joy in our hearts as we bring to you and worship you, just like your word says. Lord, it's not that you need our money. We need you to have our money. We need you to control our money. So we honor you with the first fruits. Lord, it's what you've declared in your word, and you've said it's a holy thing. So with cheerfulness, we bring it to you, and we worship you with it. And we trust you, Lord, not just with our eternity and our soul, but, Lord, we trust you with our stuff. We trust you with this stuff called money, because we love you and we know you love us.
And you only have the best for us. In Jesus' name, we thank you for it. And everyone said, amen. Turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 2. Hallelujah. Just had one of the gentlemen of this church, a man that I love so much. He and his precious wife have been with me all these years. And he came up and he just a moment ago said, Pastor, I got to tell you that when I walked in the church and I looked at you, you were glowing. Hallelujah. I could just see it on your face. You were glowing. I said, I'm glowing, brother. I'm glowing in the dark. Hallelujah. Our prayer that we've been praying, how many have been praying this with me and with us corporately? I've given it to you for 2 weeks, and I won't reread the whole thing, but in there is, we say, burn up the wood, hay, and stubble of my own efforts and replace them with the refined gold of your will. And then at the end, I say, once your fire, say fire, has touched me and consumed me, Lord, then brand my heart with your passion, which is the lost and the dying. I've been teaching, not really teaching, I've just been kind of mumbling and just getting up here and slobbering and just sharing my heart about revival, because I've been in a personal revival since the beginning of this fast. And I know it's over now, but I'm still in the flow. Hallelujah. And these things, how many of you appreciated some of the things I've shared, even though it hadn't really been very great and articulate, but just to try to open up my heart. And that prayer, I felt like, well, I can't do these ramblings again this morning. I can't stand doing that again. I said, Lord, you got to give me something to teach. And I just knew it immediately. I needed to teach on the fire of God. So I want to teach for a few minutes this morning, if you'll allow me, on the fire of God. Let's pray one more time. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the privilege to share your word with your people. Holy Spirit, you are the teacher, not I. I yield myself to you, sir. I ask you to rise up big on the inside of me. Give me utterance, I pray. We'll be sure to give Jesus all the praise and all the glory, for it's in his holy name we pray. And everyone said, read with me in Acts chapter 2. The context, we'll give the first few verses just for the context. This is the day of Pentecost. It said, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly, say suddenly, there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of what? Fire. It's amazing. All these years later, we have no trouble with Pentecostals claiming tongues. Oh, yeah, we claim tongues all day and all night, because why? We're Pentecostal, and that's great. That's wonderful. I am too. I'm not picking a fight over that. But we kind of leave out that fire part. He never said they just spoke in tongues. No, it was tongues of what? Fire. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now jump down to about verse 17. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my Spirit upon who? All flesh. Your sons, your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens, I will pour out in those days of my Spirit, and they shall what? Prophesy. Now look at this. This is where I want to go. And I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath. Blood, fire, and what? Vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness, the moon into blood, before that great and notable day of the Lord come. Now, part of this will not be fully fulfilled until the day of the Lord. And the day of the Lord is, it's real simple. It's the tribulation period. So part of this is going to await the fulfillment in the day of the Lord. But how many know we have access, amen,
Because the Holy Spirit has been poured out on the day of Pentecost. We don't have to wait again until he's poured out. We can go ahead and receive him now. Can you say amen? Now, God is talking about, notice, two, not just one, but two major demonstrations of power here. Read it again. It says, and I will show what? Wonders in heaven above. That's the wonders in the heavens. And what? Signs where? On the earth. How many can see there's two things involved there? It's not just wonders in the heavens. There's also what? Signs in the earth. God didn't tell us what all the wonders and the signs would be, although he tells us a few here. But he doesn't give us a whole list. How many believe there's going to be many amazing manifestations of God's power? How many know he's not limited to do anything? Amen. All things are within his power. Amen. So just because he doesn't give us two or three chapters of a list, he says what? I'm going to do wonders in the heavens, and I'm going to do what? Signs in the earth. He said that in the heavens, the sun will be turned to darkness, the moon to blood. And on earth, he says there's going to be what? Blood, fire, vapor of smoke. Now, I've studied this for many, many years. I've read every commentary that I can find. I've read every great scholar and the commentaries and the different things. And most of them get it wrong, I believe. Because most of them just only refer to war and destruction and murder and gross sin and violence. And I'm not saying those things aren't coming, and I'm not saying those things won't be in the day of the Lord. How many know those things will be in the tribulation period? So I'm not denying that that is part of it. But some of the scholars only see, you know, cities burning and the judgment side of, you know, war and violence. But notice how it starts out in verse 19. It says, and I, who's talking? God is talking. God said, I'm going to show stuff. Now get this, because this is so important, because you can miss this whole thing. He says, I'm going to show wonders in heaven. In other words, God is saying, I'm going to put on a show. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't think God wants to put on a show with just murders and violence and burning cities. Come on, somebody, and killing people. I don't think that sounds like my God. Amen. Burning cities is not God's idea of putting on a show. People being murdered and killed is not God's idea of putting on a show. Come on, say amen, somebody. When God wants to put on a show, it's not to destroy man, but to what? Show man that he is God. Even the plagues that came to Egypt to deliver God's people, every single one of them was strategically brought, I taught this last year, to judge one of the false gods or false idols of the Egyptians, so that when God brought his children out of captivity, they would all say, he and he alone is God. When God shows himself up, hallelujah, it's not just to destroy, it's what? To deliver his people. Say amen, somebody. I might get fired up if you'll help me a little bit this morning. God says, I'm going to put on a show. Folks, he's talking about putting on a show of Holy Ghost signs and wonders. He's not talking about just burning streets and burning buildings and murders and killings. Miraculous signs and wonders are always supernatural manifestations of the Holy Ghost. So if these signs don't refer to war and destruction entirely, well, then what can they refer to? Can I teach you a little bit this morning? All right. What's the first one listed? Blood. Now, just bear with me, because I'm going to give you an alternative thought here just to think about. Is it possible that when God speaks about blood here, he's not even talking about man's blood? I submit to you, it's possible he's talking about a higher kind of blood. How many know the blood of Jesus is supernatural blood? How many know it's not human blood? It's higher than human blood. It's divine blood. So by blood, God may be talking about the whole plan of redemption here. What has been bought and paid for through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ? All of us. When a life is changed and born again or healed by the power of God, it comes for one reason. What? And Arnett taught it perfectly. The work was already done at the cross. In other words, any miraculous sign is linked to his shedding blood. Are you getting this yet? All right, let's just consider the second one, the smoke. Well, there you go, smoke. So now we know it's burning cities. No. What is this smoke? Paul, you said it perfectly. And I remind you of it all the time. How do you interpret the Bible? With the Bible. Amen. The Bible will interpret the Bible if you study the Bible. Smoke. You know, smoke is a lot of different places in the Bible. There was a pillar of smoke that rested on the tent of testimony in the Old Testament. There was vapor of smoke, and it's not referring to buildings that are burning or houses in cities that are on fire. It was a supernatural smoke. And you know what it was? It was a manifestation of the glory of God. Now, I could give you many, many verses, but quickly, can you put these up? Exodus 13, and we're going to give these real quick. You might want to write these references down, but I could give you many of them, but just give you one or two in Exodus, real quick. Exodus 13, 21 and 22. It's coming. We need it. I'm going to have to do this the old-fashioned way. Exodus 13. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of a cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, to go by day and night. Verse 22, and they took not away the pillar of cloud by day, nor the pillar of fire by night from before the people. So there's both mention, and it's what? It's a manifestation of the glory of God. Okay, Exodus 40. At the end here, or near the end, in Exodus 40, notice what it says? Yeah, at the end, verse 34. Then the cloud, Exodus 40, 34. Then the cloud, say cloud, covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And Moses, verse 35, was not able to enter into the tent of the congregation because the cloud abode thereon, and the glory, say glory, glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Now, I could give you many, many more references, but I submit to you this smoke is Holy Ghost smoke. Now, what's the third one he mentions? The fire. The smoke comes with the fire. And this is really what I want to deal with mostly this morning, because I want to talk about the fire of God. But we understand the blood and the vapor of smoke. But what about the fire? What kind of fire is God talking about? I submit to you, it's the same supernatural fire that fell on the day of Pentecost. It says, when there appeared unto the believers cloven tongues like as of fire. And they were all what? Filled with the Holy Ghost. The fire, I submit to you, is not just some building on fire or some city on fire. No, God what? God says, I'm going to show myself off. I submit to you that that fire is a reference to the fire of God. Now, where do I get this? Okay, good question. How many of you ever heard of John the Baptist? In Luke chapter 3, this was one of my precious father-in-law, Dr. Brubaker. All the verses from dealing with John the Baptist were his favorite verses in the Bible. So if he taught on them once, man, he taught on them all the time. And these were some of his favorite verses that he would teach from. God bless him. I love him. I miss him. But in Luke chapter 3, notice what it says concerning John the Baptist and what John says about the coming Messiah. In verse 16, is everybody with me? Luke 3:16, John answered, saying unto them, this is John the Baptist, I indeed baptize you with water, but one, what? Mightier than I is coming. Now notice what he says. The latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to unloose. And here it is. He who? He Jesus. He the Messiah, right? He shall what? Baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with what class?
Fire.
Come on. How is it we leave that part out? We get the Holy Ghost and we think, well, that's all I got. That's all I need. Well, that's true in one sense of the word. But there's an aspect of this fire. How many can see that? Now, here's what's so critical. Here's the next verse. Why does God want this fire? Whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and will gather the wheat into his garner, but the chaff, say the chaff, he will what? Burn with fire unquenchable. Now stick with me. John the Baptist is really looking into the future when he says this, rather than the moment in which he was alive. He's saying the one that's coming is going to baptize with the Holy Ghost and fire, and he's going to have his fan in his hand. The blood of Jesus redeems us, and the glory of God brings in the miraculous. But what is this fire? He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and fire. And he will what? Have his fan in his hand. A fan is not like our thought of a fan, with a little fan blowing the wind. That is not it. Picture, if you will, in ancient days, as they would harvest the wheat and harvest the grain, a fan, we would say a pitchfork today, a fan was very similar. It was long and it had several prongs. It was like a big, long pitchfork. And you would throw the wheat up in the air. And as the air blew, oh, hallelujah, what a beautiful picture. As the breath or the air went through, you know what happened? The wind would divide the wheat from the chaff. The wind or the breath of the Holy Spirit, when it breathes upon our life, that's what he's saying here. He's giving us a picture. We'll literally what? Separate that which is impure from that which is pure. Oh, you're going to get this in a minute. The fan in his hand, the wind, he would throw it up in the air. How many of you ever seen pictures of that? I'm not making this up. How are you old enough and students enough to know what I'm talking about? This whole younger generation, they're like, what? Bread? I just get it in a bag at Walmart. No, 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 no. Back in ancient days, they had to prepare that thing. They couldn't just throw it in the oven or go down to the dime store and buy it. They had to prepare that wheat, and they would throw it. And as the wind separated and blew the chaff away, so the wheat would fall back to the ground purer. See, until the wind and until the breath of God breathes on you, there's still impurities. Come on, somebody. There's impurities that what? He's got to what? Purge us from. John saw Jesus and said, he's going to purge these things out of our lives. What's he going to use? The Holy Ghost and... You're going to get this. John the Baptist was saying that the day was coming when the anointing or fire of God would separate the wheat from the chaff so our lives could be fully pure before God. So that's the first one. Pull out your bulletin. There it is. The fire of God, what? Refines us. The fire of God, write it down, refines us. It burns all the chaff and gets us ready for the glory. In the natural, farmers burn the chaff, but they keep the wheat. And that's what God wants to do in our lives. He wants to burn off the chaff, that excess baggage, so we can get over into his glory. Hallelujah. Are you getting anything yet? See, our chaff, just think, is excess baggage. Now, when I say excess baggage, I'm not talking about sins. I'm not talking about sins. Like smoking and drinking and chewing and going out with girls that do. I don't smoke, don't chew, don't go out with girls that do. And we just think all that sin is no longer a part of our life, so I can just zone out. Boop, I can just close my ears because pastor's not talking about me because I don't smoke, I don't chew, and I don't go with girls that do. No, that's sin. I'm talking about excess baggage. What's excess baggage? Turn to Hebrews 12. Now, there could be sin that needs to be burned up, but I submit to you, you don't have to have sin to need to be purged. You're going to get this in a minute. I'm going there, okay? I'm going to say this. Amen. Now, you can get your appetite out there so much that it creates gluttony, which was sort of what I was, and gluttony is a sin, and I've had to repent of that. But that's not even what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about known sin. Known sin, you ought to confess. You ought to deal with it. You ought to get it out and get it clean before God. And certainly that could apply. But you're sitting there thinking, well, because you don't smoke and don't chew and go out with girls that do, that this doesn't mean you. No, I'm talking about extra baggage. See, here it is, folks. God wants to burn off anything that holds you back from doing God's will. It could be oppression of some kind. It could be depression. It could be a sickness or disease. It can definitely be an infirmity that we've been talking about, an area of weakness. This is what the Bible calls weights. Weights. Hebrews 12, look at verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, and those are the ones that have gone on before us, that are in the grandstands of heaven, watching down as we run our race. I taught on this not long ago when I taught during the Olympics. But look, let us lay aside every what? And the what? So there you got two different things, don't you? Come on, folks. A sin is not a weight. A weight is not a sin. Do you see that now? He says, lay aside both. Don't lay aside just your sin. Lay aside every what? Weight. And the sin which does so easily beset us. And what? Let us run with patience the race that's set before us. In other words, we're in a race. And you don't be weighed down when you're running a race. How are you going to win a race with a 50-pound sack of lead on your back? You're going to come in last. Somebody's going to beat you. You're not going to win your race. You may not even finish your race. you may just collapse and die. I feel like I've been carrying around a big old sack of weight. In fact, weight is a perfect word for it, actually, if you want to know the truth. All you got to do is look in the mirror. Look at that weight. Every morning I look at my weight. Weight, I am casting you off. Hallelujah. Weight, you are not going to impede my race anymore. I look in the mirror and I don't see some horrible sin, but I see weights. Are you getting this yet? Come on, I'm not picking on sin. I'm saying every one of us. Now, you may be, you know, nice and skinny like my wife over there and not have to worry about weights or, you know, one of these other skinny ladies here. And so if it fits your appearance, well, then apply it to your appearance. But if it don't fit to your appearance, I got news for you. There's still other weights. Amen. My weight is real obvious. I just show up and you can see it. Some of the rest of you can hide some of your weights. And you don't just show them off when you walk in the room. Me, I just have one that everybody sees. You know what I mean? How many can see that? Weights will slow you down. Weights will slow you down in your spiritual walk and in your spiritual race before God. It'll make it hard for you to make progress. Some of you are wondering, man, there's no sin in my life, but why am I having such a hard time? Why am I not further than I am? Why am I not more grown than I am? Why am I not further in my race with God than I am? Why am I not a stronger Christian than I am? Why can't I trust Him more? It's not the sin, it's the weight. I'm helping somebody right now. Whether you weigh 104 pounds or 354 pounds, there's still weights. Now, guess what? The fire of God wants to burn off those weights. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, we judge ourselves by one another. We look at Sister Doodad, and we look at Brother Long Tongue, and you know, we say, look at all them ugly sins. I'm not like them. And we judge ourselves on one another. That's a big mistake. We should never do that. You know why? Because all you do, all you can only judge by what you can see anyway. Amen. How many ever had your eyes fool you? How many know it's possible you can look right at something and you get it all wrong? I did that once. I've done it more than once, but one I can remember real bad. Cost me, I had to learn a lesson. I was walking by a door once in a ministry, I won't even say where, and I looked and I saw two people in there. One was a man and one was a woman. And I swear what my eyes told me, there was something impure going on in there. And so I went and I didn't know what to do. I was real young. This was years and years and years ago. So I went to the chief person in the ministry and I told him, never should have done that. Because what I thought I saw, I didn't even see. I came to conclusions. Oh, I'm going to preach this because somebody needs to hear it right now. They might be watching by TV camera right now. You cannot judge another man or woman of God simply by what you even see. Your eyes will lie to you. Your eyes will fool you. Not long ago, we had somebody in this church saying, I saw a pastor over somewhere and Kay wasn't with him. And you know what? It wasn't even me. It wasn't even there. They started telling a couple dozen people that they saw me somewhere. And you know what I found out when we finally investigated? They were not even there. Somebody else was in there and came and told this person that I was in there. Now, that's total hearsay. How many of you know that's total hearsay? So she wasn't even using her eyes. She was using somebody else's eyes and coming to conclusions and just telling the whole world that I was someplace and I wasn't even, I was sitting home with my wife. Sometimes our very eyes can lie to us. You cannot judge your life by looking at other folk lives. Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? Because your eyes can lie to you, your eyes can deceive you, and you know what? Even if what you saw was what happened, you don't know what's going on inside. You don't know the circumstances that got them there. It's like this time when somebody was running their mouth here in this church because of some young man that was in this church, thought she knew everything about him. She didn't know nothing about him. Well, he went to prison because he was a pedophile, and pastors got him up in the church doing stuff. You don't even know what you're talking about. You don't even know where that young boy's been. You're so quick to judge. You don't even know that boy was put out by his own mama when he was 11 to be a male prostitute in the streets. And you're going to sit up here all righteous, like you're God, and judge the heart of people when you don't even know nothing about them? Why am I over on this? How'd me get over here on this? Somebody must need to hear this. I don't know. Even when you think you saw somebody do something and you have every reason to believe you are right, you need to shut your mouth and pray. That's what you need to do. You don't need to text 400 people. You don't need to get on Facebook and start letting somebody have it when you are running with about 2% of information. Why am I so fired up on this? Well, you get lied about a couple of times, and you'll get fired up about it too. You have somebody come along trying to destroy your name and your reputation with a bunch of half-truths and a bunch of lies, then you'll know why I'm so fired up, I guess. Anyway, let me get back to my message here. Hallelujah. We are not to judge ourselves by one another. Amen. You may see your brother stumble, your sister stumble, or whatever. You know what? You are just as capable. If the circumstances were just right, and the pressure was just right, and the devil could tempt you at just your weak moment, you'd probably do worse. I remember this, God bless you, Larry, I love you. Thank you for that text, man of God. Love you much. I remember years ago I had this, I don't know why I'm thinking of this. Jesus, help me, get off this. Oh, I tell you, I counseled this couple, and by the time I got done, because there was something in this poor brother, he wasn't doing right. I mean, he did something, I can't remember what it was. He had, I don't even want to say, but I mean, he, you know, I caught him with this, and I caught him with that, and that woman went on and on and on and on, and I heard every evil sin that poor boy had ever committed. I mean, they were married for I don't know how many years, but every year, man, she had a whole laundry list. And I mean, I sat there for an hour, and my head was spinning. I wanted to say, sweetheart, my ears are not trash cans. I don't need 30 years of your garbage in my ears. You ever feel like telling somebody like that? I prayed for them, helped them all I could. I don't think they ever came back or whatever. But you know what? I went to my associate at the time, and I sat down. I was wore out. I was literally wore out. And I, in an honest moment, I said, you know what? If I had to live with that woman, I'd be a crackhead. She wouldn't have just found a couple cigarettes in a porno magazine. I would have been a crackhead to have to live with that. See, you can look at people and come to conclusions. You don't know what's the whole story. You could be in the same place and fall twice as bad if it might have been you. Come on, somebody. Amen. My Bible says we ought to be what? Merciful to one another. My Bible says we ought to be known by our love, and love will cover a multitude of sins. Amen. And we ought to be that way with one another. Quick to love and slow to judge. And if you were here when I taught on Wednesday night last year, and I'll just bring this references back because a few of you were here, I taught on the fact that Jesus does not judge by the sight of his eyes. There are verses throughout the Old Testament that refers to the Messiah who would come and he would be blind. And one of the errors that are defined, that God hates and is defined in the Old Testament, is someone that looks to try to find sin. We ought not be that way, folks. We ought to be looking for the righteous in people. We ought to be looking for the good in people. Amen? That's what love does. What? Love endures all. Amen? What's it say? Help me, somebody. And it thinketh no aught and is long-suffering. Right? And what? Hopes all things, believes all things. And what? Endures forever and never fails. Hallelujah. Let me get back to my notes. You learning anything yet? Am I helping you here on this rabbit trail? The fire of God will burn away the weights, including anything that would hold us back in our spiritual race. So the blood of Jesus brings us into the family of God, but we have to go through the fire of God to be prepared for his glory. Now, real quick, the fire of God changes people. That's the second one there. Write that in there. The fire of God changes people. The fire of God changes us so God can use us to his glory. I just realized I haven't even sat down one time. I just now realized that. My God, the stool's up here, but I haven't even used it one time. I've been running all over this place all morning. I haven't even needed the stool. Glory be. Jesus, I love you. Whew. Hallelujah. Say this with me. Say, the fire of God can change me. We like to think that God will use trials and tribulations to change us, and he can and he will, because those things will bring patience into our lives. But trials and tribulations on their own do not build our faith. Just being in trouble doesn't build your faith. It's what you do with your faith muscle that builds your faith. It's when you push that problem off, now you're building your faith. All a trial and tribulation does is give you an opportunity to grow your faith. Amen. It in itself is sent to kill you. The devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. That trial and that test wants to take you out. But if you'll use your faith and the word of God against it, what? You'll push it out of your life and your faith will grow. I submit to you that it's not the troubles that change us. You ready for this? It's really the glory that changes us. Now, one thing I failed to say last 2 weeks that I should have, and I asked the Lord, man, I had forgotten to say it because I meant to say it several times, because the last couple weeks I've been talking about this brokenness that I've had to go through. And here's a line you need to write down somewhere. It's not even in my notes, but I need to say it because it'll help me make this point about the glory. And it's simply this: brokenness always precedes the glory. Write it down. Brokenness always precedes the glory. And I can give you many verses to prove it. Before God sends his glory, he must have a humble, broken vessel to put it in. God will not pour new wine in an old wineskin. Why? Because Jesus says once it goes in, it's going to just bust apart. God is smarter than that. That's like the same thing about the demons, people that have demons. Jesus won't cast a demon out of a person unless that person is ready to stand against the demon when it comes back. Amen. There have been many times I knew people who were oppressed with demonic activity. And the Lord just said, don't do anything. I just kept my hands in my pockets. Why? Because I knew that person wasn't ready to get delivered. I was only going to do that person harm by casting that devil out because they really didn't want it out. You can't cast me out. He likes me. He wants to keep me. Well, you better keep your hands in your pockets because if you cast that thing out, tomorrow it's going to come back, and it's going to come back with friends. And the latter state of that man will be worse than the former. How many know I'm teaching you the Bible right now? Now, how does that apply? God will not pour his glory out on someone unless they have been broken, until they have gone through a purging process, a refining process. But the great thing is that the glory has the ability to change us. Does not the Bible say we are to go from glory to? What do you think he means when he says that? In other words, the level of glory that's in my life now, it can increase next year. And the next year. Come on, somebody. And the next year. The glory. Touch three people and say, the glory will change you. Come on, say it. The glory will change you. I don't know if I'm helping you, but I'm preaching myself happy this morning. I'm looking at that clock, and there ain't no way I'm going to get through this. But let me just talk about one person, Peter. Peter's a perfect example of this. Y'all remember Peter, right? Simon Peter. This is a good picture of somebody who was changed by the fire of God. He was probably one of the best disciples Jesus had. You see him everywhere in the Gospels. He was probably the best trained, maybe the most mature, maybe the most dependable. But yet when Jesus went to the cross, Peter is the one that denied him three times. Not only did he deny him, he swore up and down he never even knew Jesus. Now, how's that for you? He's the very one that said, Lord, everybody is going to leave you, but I'll never leave you. Uh-huh. You ever heard that one from somebody? And when the heat went up, they were the first one to bail out of the kitchen, weren't they? Oh, I'll love you forever. Yeah, you ever heard that one? And it was a big bag of gas. They're the first ones to tail and run on you. And that's what Peter was. Now, why? He was too weak to be a strong witness. Can we say that? He was there, and the people hollered at him, said, hey, you're one of his disciples. You're a Galilean. You know this man. And he swore and cussed and said, I don't even know him. In other words, he was too weak to be a witness. Can we all agree on that? He had a perfect opportunity, and he had said out of his mouth to the master, oh, I'll be there for you. I'll never deny you. But when the pressure came, he was too weak to even witness. He needed some chaff to get burned off. Can you see that? It may not have been sin, but it sure was a weight. It sure was some stuff that needed to be refined and purged by the fire of God. Somebody say amen. So there's Peter, too timid to witness because he needed some chaff burned up. But when the Holy Ghost came in the upper room and came, you ready, with fire. That same Peter that just a couple weeks earlier said, I don't even know him, and cussed and swore he never knew him. What? Now the fire of God, the glory of God has transformed him. And the one guy that was too timid to witness to some little girl in a courtyard in the middle of the night stood up on day of Pentecost and preached, hallelujah, and 3,000 souls were saved. Come on, somebody. The fire and glory of God so changed Peter and so transformed Peter that once he had an upper room experience, it changed his life. And after that, he went into the streets and boldly preached the gospel. And we know historically that when he died, this is not given to us in scripture, but it's given to us in historical record. You realize 11 out of the 12, well, 10 out of the 11, because Judas hung himself, but 10 out of the original 11 disciples all gave their life and were martyred except John. John was the only one that wasn't. They tried to kill him and couldn't. But when they crucified Peter, how many know the story? He said, I am too unworthy to be crucified like my master. Crucify me upside down. How many knew that? Peter was crucified upside down. Does that sound like the same Peter that was hiding in the dark and betrayed Jesus? No, that Peter was gone. Hallelujah. That Peter died. Hallelujah. The fire of God came in. Now, he loved Jesus before and he loved Jesus after. What was the difference, Peter? The fire of God in the upper room burned the chaff away. Hallelujah. Stand with me and say it one more time. Say, the fire of God will refine me. Come on, stand. And say, the fire of God will change me. Hallelujah. Lift your hands toward heaven. God transformed Peter from a spiritual weakling to a powerful preacher. And God wants to do the same thing in your life and mine. I'm going to cut this off right now and come back next week and finish this, Lord willing, because I really wanted to talk about Moses. But here's what I know. Here's what I know. I know there's people right now in this room and under the sound of my voice and it's not another trial you need, although others were going to come. They don't ever just go away. And sometimes they come in waves, and sometimes the devil just decides, I'm going to find out what he's made out of, just like Job. I'm going to find out what she's made of, and then he'll come with all he's got. And sometimes we can discern that. But I'm not talking to those people this morning. I'm talking to people this morning right now. You love God. You've been walking with God. You are a part of this fast. You're here on Sunday. If nobody else comes, I mean, you're members of this church, you're committed. And we both know there isn't some big gross sin in your life. Now, you're not perfect. None of us are perfect, but you're not out here trying to find out a way to displease God. Heads bowed, eyes closed. There's people standing here and sitting here and under the sound of my voice right now. And you're not running from God, you're running to God. You're not afraid of God and trying to hide your stuff. No, you're running to him. You love him with all your heart. And there isn't some big gross sin in your life that needs to get called out. Maybe at one time there was, and God delivered you and set you free, and thank God for it. But I just sense in my heart the thing that he really wanted me to say today was, you know what? There's still chaff. There's still an element there of that excess baggage. It's not a sin, but there's something there that's a weight. It may still be a memory of something. It could be a lingering effect of something that somebody else even did to you. You may not have even been the one to do it. You may have been violated or abused in some way. Somebody else may have brought it on you, and now that thing is still there. And you've tried to give it to God, and you've wanted to give it to God. It might be with me. It might be your weight. Might be your weight. I don't know, because I don't judge people over that anymore. There was a day when I did, but I sure don't anymore, because I know how hard it is. I know what it takes to get it off, and God's helping me. And I say to you, if it is your weight, if your weight is your weight like me, God's going to help you. Same way God's helping me, he's going to help you.
But whatever that is, with eyes closed, no one looking around, please just be respectful of one another right now, because this isn't for everybody to see. This is about you and him. You say, Pastor, I want you to pray for me because there's a weight, and I've seen what it is, and I acknowledge that it's there, and I want to give it to God. Hold your hand up if that's you. Hold it up and keep it up if that's you. Now, don't just do it because others are doing it. Doing it because, oh, hallelujah, look at this. There's a weight. There's something that's weighing me down, and I know it, and God's shown me what it is. Hallelujah. Here's what I want to do. If that's you and you got your hand up, don't look at people, but I want you to get out of your seat and come down front. I rarely do this, but I'm going to do it this morning. If that's you and you've acknowledged there's some weight, you may be a leader in this church. You may be a council member. You may be part of the ministry staff. It doesn't matter right now in this moment. We're not talking about sin. We're talking about weights. I want you to get out of your seat and come down here. Just stand right down here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, the glory is here. The glory is here. Do you know that one? The glory is here. Oh, the glory is here. Hallelujah. 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 Come on down here. I want to pray for you. In Jesus' name, I want to pray for you this morning. I'm going to, Jesus. Hallelujah. The glory is here. Hallelujah. 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 If you'll just start worshiping, and the Lord says if you'll just lift your hands and start worshiping, he's going to lift it off of you. He's going to remove it from you. He's going to just take it from you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For somebody, that weight is another person. It's almost like a thorn in the flesh. That other person has been a thorn. And you'd sometimes get the victory, and then sometimes it would just come back. And you've asked God to remove it, and God said, my grace is sufficient. For some of you, it's a person. It may be a person that doesn't even live anymore. I don't know, but that's the weight. It's not some sin that's holding you back. It's the memory of what somebody did to you, or the weight of what some person tried to bring on you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you'll just worship him right now, he's going to take this. He's going to take this weight off of you. You ever heard that phrase? I felt like I could just walk on the air. I was so light, I just felt like I could walk on the air. Listen, that's what's going to happen when you leave this altar in Jesus' name, because that weight is going to come off of you. That weight is going to come off of you. Supernatural, says the Lord. The weight is going to come off of you by my fire and my glory. And you're going to walk in places you've not walked before. And there's a way that you will go, says the Lord, that you've not walked before. I have a new path for you that you've not walked before. And this weight, the Lord says, this weight is mine. Give me this weight and I'll take it off of you. You were not built to carry this weight, says the Lord. If you'll roll it over on me, I'll take it. Hallelujah. Oh, forgive me for my tears, but I'm just so, hallelujah, full of the Holy Ghost right now. Lord, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Lord, thank you. Thank him. I want you just to see that weight just coming off of you and going to him. Just close your eyes and just see it. Just like, Lord, whoo, man, I give that to you. Hallelujah, it's off of me now. Glory to God, I give them to you. I ain't carrying this dumb thing no more. This weight is coming off of me in Jesus' name. I'm going to give it to the Master. I'm going to give it to Jesus. I ain't going to carry it no more. Just tell him, I'm not going to carry this thing no more. I'm going to give it to him. I'm going to give it to him. Now give it to him. Hallelujah. Give it to him. Hallelujah. Let it roll off of you. Hallelujah. And roll over on him. Lord, it rolls off of me and it rolls over on you. Come on, just somebody say that right now. Say, Lord, it rolls off of me. Come on, somebody say it. Say, Lord, it rolls off of me and it rolls over on you. Now just praise him. Oh, the glory. Yes, the glory is here. Sing it, Bill.
I can sense his mighty presence in this very atmosphere. Whatever you may need,
I don't know every word, tell me.
Just reach out.
Just reach out and take what you need, for my presence is here. You don't have to carry that weight any longer, for my freedom is here. The way's been made, the word's been taught. Reach out and claim it. Be free. If you only believe.